is Ryan Perry. I'm the pastor here at Cynic Baptist Church. We're thankful to have you guys. It's a special night tonight. A special night for you guys. It's a new chapter in life. And some of you parents will be crying tears of sadness. Others will be crying tears of joy because you're looking forward to them moving out of the house. And so wherever the tears come from, we're thankful. I want to just let you know of a couple things. Everybody probably has one of these. We just want to make sure they're on silent. We don't want your phone call to ruin somebody's special occasion. So turn it on silent, or better yet, off. We would sure appreciate that. There are restrooms out the back door on either side. The men's is over here on the left, and the ladies is over here. I just want to say, as a pastor of Seneca Baptist, we're thankful for the longstanding relationship that we have with OCA. We're thankful for the ways that we can serve one another and be a part of your lives. And so we're glad that you're here tonight. And it's going to be a great time as we celebrate this milestone in life. So thanks for being with us.
Welcome, students, parents, and faculty, to the class of 2018 graduation. This day is the culmination of years of hard work by the class of 2018. I thank all of you for being here this evening as we recognize this very special day. Without further ado, I have the pleasure of doing the pledges over the intercom every day of the year. So we're going to go ahead and do that. So first, we're going to go to the American flag. Attention, salute, pledge.
You were the one that started it all, and you were the example You are the example of how teachers should love their kids and put them first. And I was blessed enough to have you twice. Ms. Strickland, I want to thank you for all the memories this year with your fourth grade class. I truly had a blast in being your aide. I truly had a blast, and being your aide was one of the things I looked forward to every day. Mrs. Cooper, I want to thank you for all the laughs you had this year. You, along with all of the elementary teachers, are what made OCA fun for me this year. Mrs. Woodman, I cannot thank you enough for all you did for me in accounting this year, although it was a pain most of the time. And I promise that when I get my first accounting job, that you will be one of the first people I call. Mr. Charlton Dennis, our friendship over the past 4 years has been nothing short of amazing. All the times I came to you for advice or guidance, I'll never take for granted. Ms. Strada, everything you did teaching us Bible over these last 3 years has been, God has used that greatly in my life, and I know in the lives amongst these students, so we thank you for that. Mr. Glenn, Dr. Chaplin, and Mrs. Keaton, I can never thank you enough for all you did for me throughout the scholarship process. You all had a major part in this great accomplishment. It is rare for someone to get a full ride to any university. And so for that, my parents give you a major. Dr. Chaplin, Mr. Glenn, and Mr. Blinney, God used all three of you greatly in my life with the example of being a godly man that stands for what is right. Mr. Steele, I praise God that we have been blessed with you as our athletic director. As I have gotten to know you over the past few months, I am in full support of you and what you stand for. You have a true passion to see OCA grow, and as you come alongside Mr. Bateman, I cannot wait to see how God uses the two of you to accomplish great things in this school. And finally, Mr. Bateman, I believe that God cannot have picked a better person to lead our school in the stage it is in right now. I know that you fear the Lord, and you long to see Him work among the student body of OCA, and you also have a true passion to see OCA grow to its full potential, and for that, I thank you. Now to our parents. It was you that loved us unconditionally since the day we were born. I know it's not easy raising the best class that OCA has ever seen. Your sacrifice of putting us through OCA has not gone unnoticed and unappreciated. Although OCA played a significant role in preparing us for the future, it all started and will continue in the home. We will always be your baby boys and girls no matter where life takes us. From this point forward, OCA will not be a part of our everyday lives, but you will. We are with you till the end as you are with us as well. We can never repay you for all that you have done for us. We thank you for all the times you fed us, changed our diapers, made sure we looked somewhat presentable, helped us with our homework, gave us life-changing advice, and so much more that goes unnoticed. I want to especially thank my own parents, Joey and Deborah Wright. Mom and Dad, I just want you both to know that I love you, and I always know that you both love me. Your godly examples at home through all these years has been used by the Lord in my life in so many ways. I have never been prouder as a son to have the parents that God has blessed me with. Mom, I am forever grateful for all the times you kept me accountable with my schoolwork and made sure I got everything done. All of my accomplishments over the years are because of you. Dad, you have been a wonderful example of what it means to be a godly husband and father. You have a tremendous impact on the kind of man I want to be as a husband, father, co-worker, and friend. And for that, I give God the glory. Join me in applauding all the parents and teachers for all that they have done for us all these years. Now we're going to be entering into a time of worship as Ms. Ballad leads us with a song, so would y'all please stand as she leads us in this time of worship.
We truly give God all the honor for everything that's been accomplished. And so we want to go into a time of worship and give glory to the Lord. I was able to co-direct alongside of Savannah to make our senior video, as well as Silas, who spent his time with the editing and publishing. As a class, we all wanted to tell our stories. There are three members in our class, Savannah, Silas, and Veronica, whom you will see the video focus on. Each person started OCA at different points in their lives and struggled with different things. These are their real-life stories and testimonies. We wanted to point out the struggles and experiences that we have faced in high school, and also link to our source of comfort and peace, God and His Word. We hope that everyone who watches our video is encouraged and reminded of the promise that we can have victory through Christ in every hardship that we may face.
I've been a student at OCA for 14 years, starting in K-4, so I've been surrounded by the gospel since I was very young. My family and teachers loved me enough to present the gospel to me every day, not only through their words, but how they lived out their lives each and every day. I am so blessed to have grown up in this environment. That being said, I have not always cared about God's free gift to me like I should. Many times, in elementary and in middle school, and even some in high school, I just brushed off the gospel as something good to talk about, but not something that I should allow to change my life. Through the patient witnessing of others and God's never-ending love towards me, God saw fit to make me one of His own children around the time of my sophomore year. Now that I am truly aware of what God has done for me, I live in constant awe of His grace and love towards me and others.
At the beginning of 2017, I went through a time period where I was unable to sleep because of my fears and uncertainties of the future. This apprehension was a complete lack of trust for God. Every worry and doubt I know shaped in my mind was an illusion because none of it had even taken place. When things I imagined didn't go as planned, I felt upset at God for messing up my own performance. I feel like, as a high school, all of our sin is stress. In hearing, I was relying on my own understanding, not God's. Because, really, what does worry do for us? Does it bring us closer to our goals? Does it lead us closer to God? Does it help us grow our faith? No. Anxiety does not bring us closer to God. It brings us farther away. As we cast our minds onto ourselves and what's worth us, we stop focusing on what God will truly want.
I've traveled all my life and have lived in over 3 countries. So moving schools wasn't that big of an issue for me. Rather, it was the environment. I had never been to such a small school before, or even a Christian school before, so I was a bit nervous. I remember feeling a bit isolated in my first year here. Since everyone had practically known each other since birth, it wasn't unusual when I felt like an outsider. It was also during this time that I was given the opportunity to grow closer to God. Since then, I've changed a lot, and my personality has become much more outgoing, and I've met friends that I'll probably have for a lifetime, and I'm so grateful to God for that.
Is a young man or young woman who is number one,
profess faith in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. That's the requirement, number one. And then we're looking for someone who is after God's own heart, who serves his or her fellow man, whose life exemplifies the fruit of the Spirit, who is consistently reading and meditating on God's Word, someone who spends time before the Lord in prayer, someone who lives at peace with all people, and someone who personifies Oconee Christian Academy's mission and vision. That's what we're looking for. Now, the hard part is that we've got a whole group of people that fit that description. And we've got a whole school full that fit that description. We're very blessed. But through the nomination process and through the selection committee, this year the first recipient of the Warrior Award is our salutatorian, and I'm going to ask him to come to the stage, Silas Strong.
And the overall inspiration from the entire school community. To these mentors, I say, our success is your success. For you have given us the courage to dare, the knowledge to excel, and the belief that we can succeed. You've been there for us with encouragement and care. You've had faith when we doubted ourselves. You have instilled in us the self-confidence needed to reach for our dreams. For all of these things, we, the class of 2018, thank every single one of you. To OCA writ large, I thank you for giving us the Christian values upon which we will build our lives. Dr. Chapa, I'm sorry I drove you crazy with all my questions, but I thank you for your patience and for teaching me the math and physics skills that I'm going to need as I pursue my dreams in engineering. Mrs. Stratterman, your compassion reflects the Christian values that you teach in Bible class, and I thank you for it. Mrs. Keaton, thanks to you, I finally learned how to write an essay of which I can be proud. Mr. Dennis, you have pushed me just hard enough, and I thank you for coming in when we really needed you. Mrs. Turner, muchísimas gracias, señora, por todo, and thank you for teaching me how to organize a notebook. Mr. Glenn, we started this journey together, and you have been an indelible and inspirational factor in my life for the last 6 years, so for that I thank you. And finally, Dr. Looney, you are a special gift to our school and to every student whose life you have touched. And on a personal note, I want to thank my mother and my father for the examples they've set and the support that they've given me as I pursue my dreams. I also want to thank my grandmother, who's here today, and my grandfather, who is here, I know, in spirit, for the beauty they have given to my life. And thank you, Theta. As a child and great-grandchild of Middle Eastern immigrants, I know firsthand the positive impact of immigration on this great nation built by immigrants. And to my fellow classmates, I say, the future is ours. We have but to grasp it. It is no cliche to say that our generation can change the world, and I believe we can and will be a force for good. And as Ralph Waldo Emerson once said, the only person you are destined to become is the person you decide to be. God bless the class of 2018, God bless you all, and God bless America.
So when you ask a class like this, who is your preference to have one of our faculty have some thoughts, some commencement thoughts? It's very difficult for a class like this because we have such an excellent faculty and staff here. But this class decided that they wanted one of their favorite teachers to address them. And it's my privilege to invite Dr. Joe Chapel to come to address the class and our commencement assembly.
Full of danger. Well, I say you're going into a world full of power. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, in his book, Life Together, says, according to God's will, Christendom is a scattered people, scattered like seed into all the kingdoms of the earth. That is its curse and its promise. God's people must dwell in far countries among the unbelievers, but it will be the seed of the kingdom of God in all the world. That is the world God is sending you out into as you close this chapter of your life and begin the next. And the key reminder is to remember who you are as a child of God, a disciple of Jesus Christ. Zechariah 10:9 says, though I scatter them among the peoples, yet in distant lands they will remember. So tonight I want to give you two pieces of advice that I've learned from over 30 years living as a Christian in the workplace. And I might throw in a couple Air Force stories. And you had to expect that. The first piece of advice is, fly the flag of Jesus Christ over your life. Now what does that mean? You know, in every military installation, there's a ranking commander. And at big bases or big army posts, these commanders are often general officers. And my last base was Hanscom Air Force Base in Lexington, Massachusetts. And the ranking officer was Lieutenant General Ron Cavish. He was a 3-star commander of the Electronic Systems Center. The building I worked in was right next door to his building. And outside his building were 3 flagpoles. And the center flagpole, the tallest one, was of course the American flag. The flagpole on one side was for the Air Force flag, and the flagpole on the other side was for General Cavish's 3-star flag. But it only flew when he was in the building. If he was away on travel, they didn't fly his 3-star flag. And that's what I'm talking about when I say fly the flag of Jesus Christ over your life. Wherever you go, raise Jesus' flag above your life so that everyone around you knows that the commander is in. That King Jesus resides here and he is in. Now how do you do that? Well, talk about your faith. Conduct yourself as a child of God according to his word. Make sure that you're always prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you, to give a reason for the hope that you have, as it says in 1 Peter. While I was in the Air Force, I had the opportunity to work on the first ever Expeditionary Force experiment in 1998. We had 8 months to build, test, and conduct a live-fly experiment with 33 aircraft all flying with experimental command and control equipment on board. I led the airborne command and control section, and my deputy was Captain Joe Simpson. Joe knew I was a Christian because I was flying the flag of Jesus over my life. He told me he was an agnostic, and I found that to be true. He didn't believe one way or the other about the gospel, although he did tell me that he didn't see enough proof to convince him of the truth of the gospel. We spent a lot of time together over those months, and as we talked about our lives, I would bring scripture to bear on what was going on in my life. Joe seemed disinterested, but I just kept flying the flag. Joe's primary career in the Air Force was a weapons controller on AWACS, Airborne Warning and Control System. You've seen a picture of that airplane in my classroom. It's that one with the big Frisbee on top. Joe had fought on board AWACS in the first Gulf War. And while working for me on this big experiment, Joe was notified by Air Force personnel that they wanted him to deploy overseas for a year without his family to work as a weapons controller on AWACS. He had already deployed several times without his family, and now that he was coming up for major, they wanted him to deploy again. Joe's marriage was already strained because of his frequent and extended absences, and his wife had had enough. The Air Force gave Joe 3 days to either accept the assignment or put into separation papers and leave the Air Force. Joe decided to leave the active duty Air Force and join the Air Force Reserve. He moved his family to Texas, and he began his civilian career. Several years later, Joe emailed me, asking if I would write a recommendation for his application to a PhD program at University of Texas. I said, sure, and I wrote the recommendation, I sent it off to the school. About 3 weeks later, Joe called me, and he said, thank you. I said, hey, you got into the PhD program? He said, no, not yet. I called to let you know. Yesterday, I gave my life to Christ. I'm just going to say thank you. Both he and his wife are believers, and their marriage has never been stronger. Fly the flag of Jesus over your life, and God will provide opportunities to glorify him. Matthew 5, 14 and 15, Jesus says, you are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and and it gives light to everyone in the house. Don't hide your faith in Jesus. Fly his flag for everyone to see. The second piece of advice I'm going to give you is be excellent at what you do and how you do it. Now you've got that Jesus flag flying over your life. King Jesus is in. Don't be mediocre. Be excellent. Treat people excellent. Now that Jesus' flag is flying over your life, what you do and how you do it reflects on him. If you're a college student, be an excellent college student. Work hard in your studies. Focus on the task at hand. If you're an auto mechanic, work at being the best auto mechanic in your shop. Don't take shortcuts to shave some time off the job and make a few extra bucks. If you're an accountant, work at being the best, most ethical accountant in your area. And put your customers' interests ahead of more profit. If you're a nurse, an engineer, an astronaut, a financial analyst, a soldier, whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might. That's in the Bible. You're working for the Lord, not for men. That's in the Bible. Philippians 2 says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves. Not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. Late in my Air Force career, I had the opportunity to run a very large airborne radar development program. First of its kind. I was a lieutenant colonel, and I'd been an engineer and program manager in the Air Force for about 17 years. And this was my chance to run a major Air Force program the way I thought it should be run. Applying biblical principles and how I dealt with the people that worked for me and how I dealt with our contractor, the Boeing Company. I basically put those Bible verses I just read in the practice. Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might. Work as though you're working for the Lord, not men. And look out after the interests of others and put them ahead of your own. So at the start of the program, I spent a lot of time in Seattle at Boeing learning what motivated them as a company. It turns out they're like any other publicly traded company. They were in the business of making a profit for their shareholders. I learned how my decisions as the Air Force program manager impacted their ability to make a profit. They learned from me that I had high standards for how I expected them to perform. No cost overruns, remain on schedule, and anticipate problems and work them off before they became big problems. The biblical approach helped establish a relationship of trust between my government team and Boeing. At one point, Boeing's costs were going to exceed what I had in my budget. I told them I could go to the Pentagon and tell them that we were a broken program and we needed more money. Or, Boeing, you could help me fix this problem and we'd be one of the only few successful programs in the Air Force. So they came in and offered to defer $6 million of profit for 6 months into the next year when I had additional funding to cover it, so they could cover their current costs. They took a big risk deferring their profit. They would have to perform excellently for 12 months to get that profit back. Well, they did. And they received their profit. In fact, it was a report card I gave them. You thought report cards were over the school? No, I gave a report card to Boeing every 6 months. And they got a very high grade, and they got all their profit. After 3 years of development, that program was assessed as the most successful program of hundreds of programs on base. It was on schedule. It was on budget. Boeing was doing well. In fact, because of that, they were putting their best people on my program, which made the program even more successful. That's not really the point of the story. 12 years later, long after I had retired from the Air Force, I received a lengthy letter and an invitation to a promotion ceremony from an Air Force officer being promoted to full colonel. As a young captain, he was one of my financial analysts on that new radar program, and now he was being promoted to full colonel. He was a Christian, and in that letter he told me that he had learned so much on that program about how to apply biblical principles on the job and in the workplace, and that he had applied those same principles on every job he had since. And in fact, he was now teaching young officers those same principles. So I had an opportunity to set high standards of excellence and put others' interests ahead of my own. And unbeknownst to me, a young Christian Air Force officer was discipled. And he in turn was discipling others. And God is glorified. Don't be mediocre. Be excellent at what you do and how you do it. So if you are scattered living seed into a world which you do not belong, remember, fly the flag of Jesus over your life. And be excellent at what you do and how you do it. These two points are summed up very nicely in Matthew 5:16. It says, let your light shine before others see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Congratulations, class of 2018. May God bless you every morning.
Knox Davison White. first time, I now present to you the Oconee Christian Academy Class of 2018. As high school graduates, you may now move your tassels.
Those who build up and those who tear down. But Lord, I pray for these graduates. as they go out into this world, Lord, that you will just give them a continuing heart to be like you, to lift up, to banish fear, to love on those who need you, to take their careers, Lord, to just be everything that they do to glorify you. I thank you for this school and the opportunity to have this mission to teach them a biblical worldview, to be intentional about our teaching, and Lord, to where they have been trained every day to go to class, and the curriculum has been laid out for them. They go to math, they go to English, they go to science, they go to Bible. But Lord, I pray that they'll continue to be intentional about their lives now as they go out into the world. And Lord, that they continue to set time aside to serve you, to go to church, to serve with their families, to look for mission opportunities, just to bless, to be a blessing to you and for you. And Lord, they don't have to struggle about trying to live a life that's pleasing to you, but Lord, just to live a life that you can live through. And every day that they grow up and they get up, it's just a day to say, Lord, just like the lilies in the field, use my life to bring glory and beauty to you. Service is a beautiful thing, and it is a high virtue. And Lord, I pray that you would use it well. Bless their families. Bless their lives. Show them all the opportunity they have to serve you. Thank you, Lord, for these two great head of school men here. Thank you for Brother Dean Baer and his life of service that he has given to the school and what it means to these young people and their families. And thank you, Lord, for the days ahead as we continue to serve you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Seniors, if you'd like to go and pick up your candles from your seat. Ambassadors for Christ. And now, beauty of this candle lighting ceremony is that they get to participate in passing the light that was given to them on to the next senior class at OCA. Junior class, would you come forward? Juniors and seniors, you are the light of the world. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. We are now asking our Father who is in heaven to bless each one of you as you take your lights into the world and as you continue to shine. Let's go into the world.
There is a in every soul, some bright and early.
Some light so grand, and makes it all.
So